Hey, what's up, y'all? And of course, welcome to another Alternative Factuals video. And today we're going to be talking about the magical sources within Marvel Comics. And before I, get into the usual or anything like that, before I get deep into the video, mind you, a lot of these, I guess, personal sources of power or different sources of powers actually apply very similarly to DC Comics. So if you take the time to Google this, look this up, you'll see that a lot of this stuff is actually pretty much cut and dry for the DC universe as well. So you can apply this video to DC in terms of the way that their magic works in their universe. But before I get started into the topic of the video, please be sure to like, share, and of course subscribe and leave a comment down below. And like I said, don't forget to ring that bell so you can get all those notifications and all that stuff about the video. And without further ado, let's kind of jump into today's topic. So with the movie Shazam, I had me thinking, hey, there are various sources of magical power out there in the Marvel Universe, in the DC Universe. So I'm wondering, how come no one really explains, where people draw their power from? I know there's various, magic users within DC and Marvel, like I said, but I guess to kind of focus on Marvel. Various users of Scarlet Witch, for example, her using chaos magic, Doctor Strange using the Eye of Agamotto, obviously to summon different energies from extra dimensional beings and all that stuff. And even the Crimson Bands of Sidorak or the Gem of Sidorak, which basically gives the Juggernaut his strength, his power. Where does it all come from and how is it necessarily really relevant in the Marvel Universe in terms of what are its sources of magical power? What does it have to do with each of these prospective universes, aka editorial companies? So even in DC Comics, I've said twice already, there are about four magical sources in the universe. They're very specific. Obviously, anyone who uses magic, there are subcategories of different magic and abilities which you can use them for, which I'm not going to get into. I'm getting into the four primary means of tapping into magic in these universes. So I'm going to start it off with something that's actually relatively basic, and it's not going to be too crazy, but this is personal energies. Now, these personal energies are mental and spiritual powers that usually any form of mystic or sorcerer can develop for themselves. So this includes psionic energy or chi manipulation, a lot like Iron Fist, his ability to manipulate the spiritual and mental energy in his body, which forms chi, which allows him to accelerate his healing or heal others, as well as make his fists indestructible or anything along those lines. So that is what we call personal energy. Now, I know that this is completely irrelevant to Marvel and DC Comics, but a show that I think depicts magic pretty well and actually gets into a lot of the concepts of magic would be The Vampire Diaries. And of course, one of my favorite characters being Bonnie, aka the Supreme Bennett Witch. And they explain a lot about magic, where you have personal magic where you're drawing a lot of energy from yourself, or you can draw energy from natural occurrences like the wind, fire, water, all that stuff. So that's just something you want to keep in mind so that we can go check that out and see a lot of what magic has to do, but that's personal energies. Now, before I move on to the next one, something I almost forgot is personal energies can be actually very exhausting. Usually, personal energies do have some sort of caveat or some sort of negative side effect if used for an extended period of time. So I'm going to use Iron Fist, for example. He can use his chi to kind of, use his fists, make him indestructible, make his fists indestructible, and even accelerate his healing. But I'm pretty sure everyone who reads Marvel Comics or even has a very basic understanding of the Iron Fist and how he uses his powers, if he uses it for too long of a period of time, he can actually run out of chi for a short amount of time, which would require him to meditate, concentrate to replenish his chi. Now, depending on which version, I won't say which version, but what point in time you're catching up with Danny Rand or which version of the Iron Fist, usually some can recuperate a lot faster than others. But nonetheless, there is a price to pay for personal energies just because you're not drawing it from somewhere else. Now, the next category is ambient magic, or I guess energy of that particular universe. So this is usually magic that usually most sorcerers like Doctor Strange or even Doctor Fate usually tap into initially besides personal energy. Personal energies, like I said, are used for I would say smaller spells, but ambient magical energy is a primary means in which a lot of sorcerers use their magic Magicians usually can tap into like power for many different effects, such as like teleportation, energy bolts, thunderbolts, anything along those lines. And this usually derives from the universe that they're in. Now, as we know in Marvel Comics, Doctor Strange, obviously, the universe itself actually has a physical form, a physical manifestation, obviously, which we call Eternity. Now, this usually generally involves, like I said, casting spells and maybe to a limited degree, like the main dimension of like different types of energies that may exist. So cosmic energy can be included in in magic, especially in Marvel Comics. But like I said, that depends on the story and the plot and what story they're trying to tell. So that is basically what ambient magic is. That's usually the primary means in which a lot of magicians use their abilities. All right, now in this category, which is extra dimensional magical energy, this is one of the most interesting categories we're going to be discussing. I think I could probably go on for this for like an hour by itself. But what makes extra dimensional energy a lot more powerful is you're drawing energy from a dimension that is not your own. So that's usually gained, like I said, through extra dimensional energy and by invoking entities or objects from alternate dimensions and mystical dimensions and just things that have different magical laws that don't necessarily apply to your specific universe. So I'll give you a primary example, the gem of Sidorak. Now, Sidorak is based another being in a totally different dimension that is with that is his own, as well as he is a very powerful being in himself, and he can do some massive amount of damage in his within his own dimension, actually, and also he can do some crazy damage in other people's dimensions as well. And he was one of the original, I believe, Octessence, which was actually like a council or a collective of beings similar to Sidorak. And Sidorak is usually considered a deity or a demon, or you know, who was received worship on Earth. And due to some circumstances, he was banished from Earth, and then he took up the dimension. Well, he took up residence in a dimension known as the Crimson Dimension. So you have things like that. I'm not going to get too deep into his history. I was just using him as an example. But you have people like that who are extremely powerful. And like I said, there's a spell that Doctor Strange has used, the Crimson Bands of Sidorak, which is something he's invoking from an alternate dimension where he's summoning power from an alternate dimensional being. And this is also the same power that gives Juggernaut his powers, which is why he is unstoppable in more ways than one. So you have things like that that make it very interesting. Also, you have like when Scarlet Witch was actually tapping into the power of C'thone. And that's what made that whole House of M situation extremely interesting, simply because she was able to affect the multiverse, which is a form of energy that most people can't really seem to use. Even the powers of Owen Reese, even though it's not magical, it is still the source of his power and the reason why he can affect matter on a multiversal level. But let's get into the fourth category of sources of magical power. The fourth source would be items. Now, this one can, you know, mix in, you know, it's all based on how you feel. And items obviously can be extremely powerful, like the Crimson Gem of Sidorak, or it can have basic items or items that are still powerful in their own right, like the Eye of Agamotto, for example. So these items still to some degree can grant someone some sort of magical power. Now, I'll take a reference from DC, where you have like the Helmet of Fate, where basically Dr. Fate draws his power from the laws of order, the Lords of Order in the DC comics, using that helmet. So the magic may come from a form of item imbued with power, and these are often created by, you know, either sorcerers or extra dimensional entities. And much like I said, it varies based on how they function and the type of power that they grant or what they can do with that magical item. So those are the four main primary sources of magical power, primarily in Marvel Comics, but it can apply specifically to DC as well. If you're new to the channel, please be sure to like, share, and of course subscribe. Let me know about any other chats or any kind of other things you want to talk about, and be sure to check out Vampire Diaries, simply because it is a very interesting show and they do talk a lot about magic, and they actually cover a lot of this in their show. And I hope to see you later on. Peace out.